is a practice of self-immolation of a widow either on her husband's pyre or separately after her husband's death. Sati is portrayed as a regressive custom that was widely prevalent throughout India. British records, as well as Christian missionary records from 1800 onwards, indicate anywhere between 10,000 to 100,000 cases of Satis every year. In this video, we will analyze the empirical data to examine this claim, because numbers don't lie. The Rig Veda talks about the first known instance of an aborted Sati. It describes a cremation where a widow who was lying beside her husband was not allowed to kill herself. Scholars generally date the Rig Veda between 1900 BCE and 1200 BCE. Although it is debatable considering these dates, for now we have only one recorded aborted instance of Sati in this 700-year period.
The Mahabharata records at least three events of self-immolation: that of Pandu's wife Madri, that of Vasudeva's four wives, and the self-immolation of five of Krishna's wives after his death. The Ramayana, whose origins are more eastern, record no evidence of self-immolation. In a span of 1,500 years, from 1,900 BCE to 400 BCE, there are only four recorded instances. The first recorded foreign account of Sati Pratha is that by Diodorus of Sicily and describes an eyewitness account of Hieronymus of Cardia, approximately 326 BCE. A lady called Pustika committed self-immolation around 300 AD, and the remains were discovered in a pot unearthed in a village in the region. In 510 AD, Goparaja, the chieftain of King Bhanugupta, died while fighting against the Maitras, and his widow committed self-immolation in Iran, Sagar district.
In Sanski, a village in the Kolhapur district of Maharashtra, a Sati stone inscription dated to 550 CE was found. In 606 CE, Queen Yashomati, the mother of Harsha and the wife of King Prabhakar Vardhana, committed preemptive Sati when it became apparent that her husband had no chance of survival. The 842 CE Dholpur inscription of Rajasthan records the Sati of Kanahula, wife of Chand Mahasena. The Ghatial inscription of Rajasthan, dated to 890 CE, records the Sati of one Samvala Devi, wife of Ranuka. In 1955 CE, the wives of Parantaka Chola I committed self-immolation. It is said that he had 11 wives. In 973 CE, Vanavan Mahadevi, the queen of Sundara Chola, self-immolated herself on her husband's pyre.
Epigraphic evidence from Karnataka records only 11 instances of Sati in southern India between 1000 AD to 1400 AD and 41 instances between 1400 AD to 1600 AD. Sati was rare enough that instances of it were memorialized and valorized. As the evangelical Christian movement started gaining more prominence in India starting from 1800, enumeration of Sati incidents skyrocketed, and suddenly annual 10,000 Sati incidents were being reported from Bengal alone in 1803. A mind-boggling increase of 2,000 times, and some even suggested 50,000 Sati occurrences annually. The sudden increase in the documented rate of Sati under the British government can be due to one of the following reasons. 1. The data is unreliable and fabricated, exaggerated to support missionary propaganda and justify the civilizing mission of the British. On the other hand, if the data is accurate, what change of conditions during the British Raj in Calcutta led to this spike?
If we add up all the Sati incidents from 1900 BCE till 1900 CE based on actual eyewitness accounts and epigraphic records, there are hardly more than 500 unique incidents over a 4,000-year period, or an average of one Sati every 8 years, and nowhere near the 10,000 per year incidents recorded by British colonizers and Christian missionaries.
So, let's analyze it systematically and numerically. We assume that the evidence represents only 5% of the self-immolation incidents, and that 95% of incidents remained unreported. Based on the above assumptions, If we restrict ourselves to the period between 1400 AD and 1800 AD, we come across not more than approximately 400 reported cases, which translates to 8000 estimated cases of sati. In 1400 AD, India's population was around 9.8 crores, and by 1800 AD, the population increased to 18.9 crores. The average annual population during this period was 14.4 crores. Concerning the average population in those four centuries, how significant are the estimated 8000 sati cases?
Today, the death rate in India is 7.3 out of 1000. In earlier eras, when medical science was not as advanced as today, the average death rate was much higher. Since we don't have data for this, we have assumed that 4.5% of the population died every year, which translates to a death rate of 45 out of 1000. Thus, the average number of deaths per year was 65 lakhs. Of those 65 lakhs, many were children, as infant mortality was very high in those centuries. Many deaths were of unmarried people and so on. It is assumed that 1/6 of those who died were men who left behind their widows. This translates to 10 lakh widows on average per year. Of these 10 lakh widows every year, only 20 committed self-immolation.
It is obvious that even assuming 95% underreporting, sati pratha was a very rare event and only 1 out of 50,000 widows committed sati. But let's go further. Even if we assume that 99% of sati instances were unreported or that only 1 out of 100 cases were recorded, even then, not more than 1 out of 10,000 widows committed sati, assuming a CDR of 4.5%. If we were to stretch this thin and assume that the fantastic missionary-inspired government data from 1815 to 1828 to be true, even then, not more than 1 in 400 widows in Bengal Presidency committed sati every year. To put things in perspective, 1 out of 50,000 widows committed sati every year, assuming 95% underreporting. 1 out of 20,000 women commit suicide in the UK every year. 1 out of 10,000 US citizens die on account of gun violence. 1 out of 3,500 women die from honor killings in Pakistan. So where do these huge numbers come from?
Sati was an obscure practice for all practical purposes. Yet, the British colonizers and Christian missionaries decided to collaborate despite being sworn enemies and sensationalized the obscure tradition by bringing it into the limelight. The fabrication of data and the subsequent enactment of sati prohibition helped both the groups. The colonizers could now show a legitimate reason for ruling over India and continue their civilizing mission, and the Christian missionaries could continue their program to convert the heathens. A majority of foreign writers before colonial times talk about how rare the practice of self-immolation was. However, such voices were ignored when data for sati was being tabulated, and fantastic numbers like 10,000 incidents per year were being fabricated.
The data we have furnished indicates that there was a surge in the numbers of sati incidents after the 12th century, when Islam became a dominant force in India and when northern India started being ruled by various Muslim warlords. The sati that we know of today in our history and social study textbooks must be viewed in a historical context for what it is: an almost forgotten obscure custom, exceedingly rare, practiced by perhaps a handful of communities in some specific geographies, being suddenly brought into the spotlight and sensationalized to shame, control and convert the Hindus. Stay tuned, stay educated, and last but not the least, know your culture by self-investigating the truth. Shubhaste Panthanas Santu. Jai Hind, Jai Bharat.